Good morning, St. Paul's United Church of Christ in Erie, and all of anyone else who's watching. Good morning to you, and blessed Sunday. This is our sixth Sunday of Easter, and also we keep in mind that it is Mental Health Week, and today is the United Church of Christ, as many churches are celebrating today also Mental Health Sunday. So while I wait and for those of you to gather and let your family know to come together for worship, I'll just do a little hymn here for you. It's the hymn we're going to be singing later, so that we can get to know it a little bit. I will So hopefully you got to hum along a little bit there. That's called Isaiah 49, which is actually our passage today, written by Cary Landry. So we'll be singing that in a little bit here. So welcome to our virtual worship. The posts below this one, so you know, for those of you that will be watching later, there is a post for Mental Health Sunday, some how-tos or some ideas on how to support folks with mental health issues right now, which unfortunately in this time that we're in, many, that's kind of a growing thing right now. A lot of folks suffering with anxiety and all kinds of issues, depression, the feeling of isolation. So the message, I hope, that everyone will receive. There is no shame in having any issue with mental health. Please know that. Please know you don't have to be perfect for God to love you, because He already knows our hearts. He knows our minds. He knows us. He's created us. And sometimes we're broken, and that's okay, because He loves us right in the place where we're at, no matter who we are, how we are. God's love is faithful, infinite, never-ending, and nothing, even if you're having a broken time, nothing will ever separate us from the love of God. Amen? So join me, if you will. As I said below this, besides the mental health, there's also the order of worship. If you haven't gotten to look at that, you can always copy and paste onto a document, print it. That's what we do. So join me in the call to worship. Let us pray. We long for community and the presence of God. in whom we live and move and have our being. This day, Christ tells us that we will never be alone. An advocate, Spirit of Truth, will share our journey, with whom we will live and create community and celebrate being. May the love of God be with you and the joy of Christ surround you. May we know the presence of the Advocate. As we gather in this community of peace, may your truth lead us to the path of discipleship with deeds of bold mercy and courageous justice. As an Easter people following a risen Lord, may the life of Jesus live on in us and through us. Amen. Join me in our opening prayer. O Holy God, we all live in communities where there are people whose lives are challenged by substance abuse, mental illness, brain disorders, the families of people living with serious mental health issues often feel overwhelmed and isolated by the many challenges these issues create. Holy One, create in us a tenderness to the needs of all, an openness to everyone's gifts, and a commitment to the struggle for justice. We offer this prayer in the name of the risen Christ, who makes all things new. Amen. Now, for those of you that were already on, I ask you to join with me in our song, Isaiah 49. Didn't wear the robe today because, honestly, it's a little muggy. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I'm not going to complain. I will just dress differently because my own mental health I want to keep intact. Join me in our prayer of confession. Holy Advocate, it seems at times we forget that you know us at our very depth. We become anxious and afraid that you are not with us in these days of isolation and worry. Yet even now, you call us to the work of imagination, generosity, and patience, which are possible when we remember whose we are. By your mercy, help us to live out the commandments of Christ within these walls. May we become for the world the very presence of justice, hope, and peace. My beloved family, all of us have been created and called to be in community, which today takes many forms. Know this, but more importantly, live this. As God's children, we are loved and equipped for great ministry. Follow Jesus' commandment to love boldly, even in solitude, as you are held in the grace and love of God. Amen. Now we come to a time to lift up our prayers, our joys, our sorrows, our thankfulness, our concerns. I ask if you haven't, or if you're watching this later, please, in the comment string, place whatever prayers you have on your heart that you would like to be lifted up, so that not only when I see them later, I'll lift them up as well, but so that your siblings who are watching will see your prayers and lift them up with you, so that we can pray as one body. Let us pray. Almighty, ever-living, ever-loving, gracious God, we desire to please you, O Lord. And sometimes, God, it is difficult in these times when we get riddled with things that come closing in. It is so difficult, Lord. It is so difficult to turn to you, especially when we are feeling shame for our brokenness. But, oh God, you are a big God. So we thank you that even in the midst of our brokenness, even in the midst of our imperfectness, you desire to lean in and be with us. Help us, O God, in times when we are not aware. Help us to be aware. Open our hearts and our minds. Open our eyes, O God, to your presence that is ever with us. Lord God, we thank you, O Jesus, for your presence. Father, we lift up to you all of your children. We lift up to you the city of Erie. We lift up to you our whole state of Pennsylvania. We lift up to you the whole world. Help us, O God, to turn to you. Help us to seek you, to pursue you as much as you pursue us. We lift up to you all those who are struggling with mental illness. Help them not to be ashamed, O God. And help those folks who are called to minister to those who struggle to do it perseveringly, O God. Strengthen them. Strengthen caretakers, O God. Lord, with any and all illnesses in our community, we lift it up to you, O God. We thank you and praise you for your steadfast love. Lord, we give you all honor and glory as we lift up together the prayer that your Son Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive those who hold debt against us. Lead us, O God, not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours, O God, is the glory, honor, and praise. Thank you, Jesus. Praise you, God. With us all to you, Jesus. Amen. There is so much happening in the world right now, my brothers and sisters. So much suffering. It breaks my heart, the conversations that I've been having. So many are hurting and so many are alone. And it's hard, let me tell you, it is hard. It's hard being in ministry in these times when all we can do for those of us that want to love you and minister to do it on the phone. So know that my heart is with you and my love is with you. And even if my hug is a virtual one, it is given to you. So know that you are not alone. Know that you can always reach out. Join me in the prayer of illumination. Holy Spirit of God, an inspirer of the word, may this hearing of your word draw us deeper into the mystery of your love. Help us to understand what we hear and respond to it with our lives. Let it bring the fire of your love into our lives. Make us hunger for your word, for it speaks to us of the risen Christ who alone can satisfy. Alleluia. Alleluia. Hear now the reading of God's word, Isaiah 49, verses 8 through 16. Thus says the Lord, in a time of favor I have answered you, on a day of salvation I have helped you, I have kept you and given you as a covenant to the people, to establish the land, to apportion the desolate heritages, saying to the prisoners, come out, to those who are in darkness, show yourselves. They shall feed along the ways, on all the bare heights shall be their pasture. They shall not hunger or thirst, neither scorching wind nor sun shall strike them down. For he who has pity on them will lead them, and by springs of water will guide them. and I will turn all my mountains into a road, and my highways shall be raised up. Lo, these shall come from far away, and lo, these from the north and from the west, and these from the land of Syene. Sing for joy, O heavens, and exult, O earth. Break forth, O mountains, into singing. For the Lord has comforted his people and will have compassion on his suffering ones. But Zion said, the Lord has forsaken me. My Lord has forgotten me. Can a woman forget her nursing child, or show no compassion for the child of her womb? Even these may forget, yet I will not forget you. See, I have inscribed you on the palms of my hands. Your walls are continually before me. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The prayer that we shared before hearing this text is about the word speaking about Jesus to us, who alone satisfies. But there isn't anything in this text about Jesus, right? Or is there? Now, when we get into an Old Testament text, we need to be mindful of how we understand the text. There is one rule in particular that I follow. The rule that a text can never mean what it never meant. So how in the world can we relate or see anything about Jesus in this text? Well, in thinking about our rule, we have to understand that what the text is about by first looking at its original meaning. Then if we find it has been used in the New Testament without negating the rule, we come to understand what I call a paradoxical text. There are times a text can have two meanings. The original meaning, along with its added meaning, in the New Testament. So first, let's look at the original meaning, which to do so, I'm going to take us down an expedited, speedy historical tour of the Israelites. The elect of God, the chosen ones, live hundreds of years in bondage. Then, thanks to Moses, are freed. Then they take a journey in the wilderness on what could have been an 11-day journey. But due to their stubbornness and disobedience, it takes 40 years. A generation dies because of it taking 40 years to get through the wilderness. But for those who remained alive, they were finally able to rejoice in the promises of God and see God keep his word as they enter into their land flowing with milk and honey. Fast forward now. Things are good for a few hundred years, but then the Babylonians come onto the scene. Yet again, God's chosen are placed in captivity. Now imagine, if you will, being told by prophet after prophet, maybe pastor after pastor, right? Amen. How much God loves you. Yet, time after time, your people are in chains, hungry, hurting, being bruised and beaten until you bled. Where is God? Now we go further in time. God uses an Assyrian by the name of Cyrus to come and defeat the Babylonians, and God's people are once again given an opportunity to go back to the comforts of home. This has been a heck of a roller coaster relationship between God and God's people. up and down, back and forth, sometimes even a corkscrew and a double loop of uncertainty. Then here we come to this moment in our text. God understands how they feel. God's people are worn out and tired. Tired of believing in a God that continues to leave them. Continues to what it feels like, breaking his promises. So, once again, God speaks through the prophet. For the Lord has comforted his people and will have compassion on his suffering ones. Then God, letting them know he understands what they are feeling, communicates, but Zion said, the Lord has forsaken me. My Lord has forgotten me. God then communicates an intimate picture of his love. Can a woman forget her nursing child or show no compassion for the child of her womb? Even these may forget, yet I will not forget you. See, I have inscribed you on the palms of my hands. You see, what they were unable to see is something we are able to see. Because of all that we have in God's word, we are blessed to have the whole story they didn't have. I love the statues that represent this passage that show a large hand with a little child joined to the palm, as if the hand and the little child are infused, one into the other. The little child has this quiet, small smile, which for me appears to mean that as they have joined themselves, pressing into the palm, being a part of it, one with it, that it brought complete contentment and joy. This, my friends, is an image of how much God loves us. God will always have his hand on us, and we just need to press into his presence. The beautiful imagery God gives us of God's self as mother is one of deep intimacy. So much so, God uses words that describe cutting our image into his flesh. The word in Hebrew that's translated means cutting. So God is saying, I'm cutting you into my flesh. God carves us into his palms. That's the description, which leads us into the other meaning of this text. Is it possible that God gave us this word to also communicate the revelation of Christ as the final example of this love expressed in this text? For example, in 2 Corinthians 6:2, that's referencing verse 8 of our text. Paul is pleading for the church not to take the grace of God in vain, that all obstacles that get in our way to God have been removed, and we have salvation through Christ. Then, verse 10 of our text is referenced in Revelation 7:17, letting us know that the Lamb, Christ, is the one that leads us to the springs of the water of life. Just like God describes cutting his flesh to imprint our image into his palm, Christ also took on our sin through the nails that cut into his flesh, hanging him on the cross, imprinting the souls of his children into himself in a way that nothing could ever separate us from his covenantal love. Today is Mental Health Sunday, as I've mentioned. All of us have been going through added stress, even to the degree that it has caused bouts of severe depression, anxiety, and fears. Life brings with it trials and tribulations, as it is. Add to it the stresses during this pandemic, and for some, it is too much at times. But I encourage you all, my beloved church family, to continue reaching out to each other. Like now, here we are, doing our best to communicate during this time of struggles, finding different ways of showing each other that we know, God has not left us. God is with us. I know it is difficult for us when we are in times of crisis. Like Zion, we wonder if God has abandoned us. The difference, if we but look, is that unlike Zion, we have the whole story. The divine acts and actions of God's love through history, especially through Christ. The question is, will we love God enough to imprint His word on us? Are we willing to be a living expression of the presence of God to others so that they can see God's divine action? And yes, this is a challenging time to walk through, but we are not alone. We are called to deepen our faith and remind ourselves of a God that never leaves us. Perhaps God is reaching out to you by using another person. We need to keep our eyes open for ways in which God will communicate with us, and hold fast to that truth that God is with us because of the promise that we are imprinted, carved forever on the palm of His hand. Amen.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
If you haven't done so, you want to grab your communion elements, whatever you're going to use for communion, bread, wine, juice, whatever the case may be. For Holy Communion this morning, I invite you, as always, to lend Christ your table. For all that we are, all that we have, belongs to the risen Lord. Alleluia. We remember on the night that Jesus was betrayed, He took the bread, He blessed it, He then broke it and gave it to those whom He loved. And He said, "Take this, all of you, and eat it, for this is my body broken for you." In the same way, He took the cup, again giving thanks. He looked to those whom He loved, those who were broken, imperfect. They certainly made mistakes. And still, He offered and said, "Take this, all of you, and drink it, For this is my blood poured out for you, for the new covenant, so that all may be forgiven. Drink this as often as you will, and when you do, remember me. My brothers and sisters, we are one bread, one body, one cup of blessing. Rest now your hands lightly upon these elements, which we set aside today to be a sacrament, and let us together ask God's blessing upon them. Eternal God, we unite in this covenant of faith, recalling Christ's suffering and death, rejoicing in Christ's resurrection and awaiting Christ's return in victory. We ask you to send your Holy Spirit on this bread and drink, on our gifts and on us. Strengthen your universal church that it may be the champion of peace and justice in all the world. Restore the earth with your grace that is able to make all things new. Be present with us as we share this meal and throughout our lives, that we may know you as the Holy One, who with Christ and the Holy Spirit lives forever and ever. Amen and hallelujah. My brothers and sisters, this is the food of God that you have before you, and you are the people of God. Together, let us receive the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Join me now in our prayer of thanksgiving. Bountiful God, we give you thanks that you have refreshed us at your table by granting us the presence of Christ. Strengthen our faith, increase our love for one another, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. Alleluia. Amen. In honor of our theme for Mental Health Sunday and this week, I offer up this song of prayer. And I ask that our Heavenly Father lay his precious hands upon each and every one of us, that healing power may it come forth for all. Touch. I ask that you bow your heads and pray for God's blessing. I pray that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. As you are being rooted and grounded in love, I pray that you may have the power to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, so that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Thank you for joining us, and thank you to those who join us later. I pray that you have a blessed rest of your week. I'll not see you on, or I should say you won't see me, next Sunday. This week is finals week, so I ask that you keep me in prayer, please. I need it. But I will see you. I'll join with you again in worship in a couple weeks. But in the meantime, lift up our minister Eric Campbell. He will be leading worship next Sunday. So I will see you all soon. God bless you.